You know, it's a real pleasure to be here today. I'm honored to be here speaking to such a great group of individuals. I want to start off by thanking you all for paying our bills in state government. You know, we know that it's the business community that certainly provides the jobs and the ability that we have as government to operate, and certainly that shouldn't be lost on anybody. I also want to thank Doug Rothwell and Mark Murray when they first called me out to Michigan from Utah. You know, I was sitting in a nice spot. My governor just won re-election out there. Life was good. We've been recognized as the best managed state, had our budget issues pretty well resolved. And they called me out and said, come meet with a few of our guys. So I came out, met with Doug, and I was very impressed with both Doug and Mark. And as we were walking out of Doug's house, it was about 70 degrees on November. And he said, this is how it's like always in Michigan. It wasn't 70 degrees when I was walking over here from the Romney building. But anyhow, it is a pleasure to be here. I look forward to working with such a great state and with all of you in solving Michigan's problem, because this truly will be a team effort. And I'm just delighted to be here. Today I'd like to cover, let's see here if I can get this thing working. Am I pointing at the wrong place?
Oh, it's just a delay.
Is there somebody else who can advance the slide? There we go. All right. I want to start by quoting one of the great Michigan folks, Henry Ford. He said, if everybody is moving together, then success takes care of itself. Certainly, we view the business community as being a key to moving Michigan forward into the future. Today, what I'd like to do is I'd like to start by talking. A lot of times, it's easy to get depressed, you know. I think Kildea summarized the areas that keep us budget directors awake at night. Pensions, Medicaid, and unfunded post-retirement health care benefits. Okay? I don't care if you're in Michigan or in Utah or anywhere else in the country, these are issues that we're all dealing with. Can you advance the slide? Was working for Kill. Is this a trick here for the budget, new budget guy? I'd like to start by focusing on Michigan's legacy of strength. Okay, Michigan powerhouse in the 90s. Everybody remembers those days, and there's still some very remarkable facts that I'm going to cover here that for you guys you might take for granted, but for the new guy on the block, they're pretty darn impressive. I'm going to talk about some of the hard-hitting weaknesses. Kill went into those quite in depth, but I want to talk a little bit about Michigan's side. And then I want to talk about our plan to move forward, the Snyder's team and vision to move forward. But first, let's start with the good news. Michigan was and is an industrial giant. Gross state product in 2009 was $340 billion, thanks to many of you. 12th in the nation. Detroit car and light sales trucks in 2010 were up 11%. It's 11.6 million vehicles. That's 45% of the market share. Things are starting to come back there. High-tech employment. You know, it's not just the automobile state anymore. We have a big high-tech industry here in Michigan, 12th in the country, with 79,000 high-tech employees. 18 of America's Fortune 500 companies reside right here in Utah. So, Michigan. I won't do that again. That was a test to see if you're all with me, okay? I'll tell you, when we went, I had the great distinction of working with Governor Huntsman, who's now the ambassador over in China. And I went walking in the pew with our new governor, Governor Herbert. And we introduced ourselves, and he said, I said, I'm here with Governor Huntsman to meet with the pew. And I got hit in the back of the head, and I've done that many times. So please forgive me, but I'll try not to make that mistake again. But I think it's important to note here that Michigan does have a lot of good things going. Okay, we're still a big country, the state, we're the eighth largest state in the country. There's a lot of positive things here happening. I would like to talk now about the public sector, which is really why I'm here, to help get the public sector reformed and take a look at state government. As Kill mentioned, go ahead to the next slide. As Kill mentioned, Michigan, I'd say, leads the state in pension reform. Okay, back in 97, we went to a defined contribution for all state employees. Okay, that means that the state puts in 4% and then we'll match another 3%. Okay, got the state out of the long-term liability business for pensions for current state employees. Okay, this is very, this is a best practice that a lot of states are looking to. I knew we tried to get here in Utah, but couldn't quite get there. And we put in a defined or a model, you know, that allowed people to have an option. But I think this is something that we really need to understand, because this really altered the long-term taxpayers' obligation by reducing that benefit. Now, we have a long way to go, because with the local governments here in Michigan, they're still on the defined pension systems. But the defined benefit pensions. But I think it's important to note that 54% of the state's workforce today is in a defined contribution model, okay, patterned after a lot of where the business is in your heading within your own organizations. We do have 55,000 retirees right now receiving state pensions, which are very difficult for us. I think, as Kill mentioned, not just pensions are an issue, but you also have the post-retirement health care benefit. One of the big problems we have as a state government today is that 13% of our payroll is charged for post-retirement, for retiree health care. Okay, so for folks who are retired, for us to make good on their retiree health care benefit, that costs us 13% of our current payroll. Okay, that's a huge cost. And that's not even to fund the long-term obligation, as Kill talked about, of funding the actuarial liability. And that's one of the areas we need to get to as a state. The other thing that I think Michigan ought to be proud of is it was the first state to fully consolidate IT. They actually led the way for Utah. Utah and Michigan are the only two states that have a consolidated IT system in place. There are some great things that government's been doing over the years. Today we have 357 online services. Just in the last decade, we went from 200,000 motor vehicle and watercraft registrations being done online to 1.2 million. Okay, just in the last 5 years, we went from 200,000 hunting and fishing licenses being done online to 300,000. And so IT is a big backbone. I know many of you are in the IT business, and certainly we appreciate your support in that. But here in Michigan, all of IT is centralized. And that really helps us to package IT in a way that can help drive the future of the state. It's really important to understand that we're not going to grow as a state government in relation to our caseload increase. Okay, the revenues are not going to grow to keep up with the caseloads that we have. I'm going to show you the Medicaid caseload slide here in a minute, and it's pretty staggering. But what we have to do is we really have to look at innovative resources, information technology really being the backbone that can help government keep up, just like it has in the private sector. Okay, IT can be a real valuable tool if we use it. Michigan was one of only two states to earn an A in the recent digital state survey. Can you guess who the other state was? Utah. Imagine that. But that is something to be proud of as a state. And I didn't throw this in here just because I was presenting with a great Kill. Pew does a lot of great work, and I am honored to be here on the panel with Kill. We've done a lot of work. I've done a lot of work with the Pew Center through the NASBO connection, the National Association of State Budget Officers, but as well as being out of one of the better managed states in Utah. Michigan, I think it's important that back in 2008, people realized that they graded the states. The Pew Center did the Government Performance Project, which is in cooperation with Governing Magazine, where they look at all of the states and say, how do these states stack up? Partially in the IT governance, infrastructure, people management, infrastructure spending, and some other things. And Michigan received a B+. There were only three states to get a grade higher. Can you guess what one of them was? Okay, that'll be the last time I mention Utah, I promise, okay? But Virginia and Washington State were the only other two states to get an A-. So I think that's something to be proud of. This next slide's pretty informative, and it kind of tells me why there's a lot of people, you know, in Michigan who have kind of seem like they've been through the war the last decade. But I think it's also there's a silver lining here, because you look at state budget gaps. There are a lot of states that are in a lot worse shape than we are. And what I want to do, let me explain this slide. In the last decade, Michigan's growth in general fund has been 0%. Okay? 0%. What has that done to our expenditures? Nationwide, it was 41%, the general fund growth. We were dead last in the country. Okay, in 2000, and if you look at on the expenditure side, total expenditure side, the expenditure side is only up 16%, where nationally it's up 47%. So when you look at all these states like Nevada, okay, 40% structural deficit. That means 40% of their budget this year is from non-recurring revenue, okay? Arizona is in a similar boat. Arizona just sold their Capitol building. Did you know that? Okay, Arizona packaged up all their state buildings, basically went out and took a second mortgage on them. They'll get them back, assuming they make the payments. But they pushed all that one-time revenue in to the current fiscal year to balance the budget. Okay, we haven't talked about selling the Capitol building. And looking at it, I don't think I'd be supportive of that, as I hope none of you would either. But I think that this creates an opportunity for us, because as we're solving this budget deficit that we're in, and it's significant, and I'm not trying to diminish the magnitude of our problem here in Michigan, but to put it into perspective, I think it's important to understand where we are. And I think that certainly we have a lot of opportunities out there, but there has been some good management over the past. Now let's look at some of Michigan's weaknesses, and I like to call them opportunities. There is a lot of low-hanging fruit here in Michigan that I think we'll be able to look at as far as value-based government, as far as implementing best practices and doing a lot of things, and I really look forward to doing that. One of the weaknesses is the rainy day fund, okay? Michigan really never came out of the 2002 downturn, as many of you probably realized that. The rainy day fund, typically the rule of thumb is that you want to have about 5% of your state appropriation sitting in the rainy day fund. Well, but more importantly, what the rating agencies look at is when you use that rainy day fund coming out. Okay, a lot of states made the mistake back in 2008 of using their rainy day fund. We were going right into an election, okay, back in 2008. And a lot of states said, we don't want to mess with the revenues right now. We all knew we were going in. I got into a meeting with all my fellow state budget directors, and they all said, oh, no, we know there's a problem there, but we're not going to address it until after November. Well, what happened is the first thing they did is they went to their rainy day fund. That's the last, you don't want to use your rainy day fund going in to the recession. You want to start to scale back your expenditures. You want to use the rainy day fund as you're coming out of the mess, and you're starting to recover. But as you can see, for the last decade, we've had negligible money in the state's rainy day fund. Right now we have $2 million in there I guess we could use, but there's not a whole lot based upon the state's $20 billion budget when you look at the school aid fund and the general fund.